Good evening, everyone, and welcome. Thank you all very much for coming. I'm Hannah Kay from Intelligence Squared. Big thank you to Ossian Ward and our very distinguished panel of speakers for coming this evening. Thanks also to the Saatchi Gallery for staging this event, to Rebecca Wilson, the gallery's associate director, for putting it all together, and to the art newspaper for their support. Before we start, I'd just like to mention some of the other Intelligence Squared events coming up this season. We've got a number of talks, and the next one is on May the 22nd, when we have the Harvard superstar philosopher, Michael Sandel, and he's going to be talking about the moral limits of markets and asking how we can protect the good things in life when everything seems to be up for sale. Then on May the 24th, we have the dashing American neuroscientist, David Eagleman, hot from the lab, where he's been studying the science of hatred and dehumanization. And he's going to be suggesting that one day science may be able to come up with social programs that will tweak our neurology and make us all nicer to each other. Then, following the success of our recent event on Syria, on June the 7th, we're staging a debate, What to Do About Iran? And we're bringing together an international panel of experts to discuss just how alarmed we should be at the prospect of a nuclear Iran. And then on June the 11th, we have a major televised debate with the BBC, and the motion is send them back, the Parthenon marbles should be returned to Athens. And we have a very starry cast with Stephen Fry and a Greek government minister, Anna Diamantopoulou, arguing for the repatriation of the marbles, and they'll be going head-to-head with the historians Felipe Fernandez-Armesto and Tristram Hunt. And you can find details of all these events and more and sign up to our mailer at intelligencesquared.com. Thank you.
Thanks to Intelligence Squared and Saatchi for putting on this debate. It's a great moment for photography right now in London. I've been to half a dozen shows over the last week in art galleries of great things, not least a great one across the road at Michael Hoppen's gallery, where I also overheard someone saying he was coming tonight, but he was going to sit near the back so he could sneak out if it was boring. I'm glad to see he's not. I always do that myself, so don't worry. But I hope we won't be boring. We've got a great panel, and I'm just going to start by sort of setting up the argument. There have never been more photographs than there are now. See, look. There's another one. And there'll be many more tomorrow. As the human population passes 7 billion, so the availability of the basic equipment necessary to fix a likeness or a landscape, whether by webcam or digicam, also grows exponentially by the day. Photography, which was once the strict preserve of darkroom professionals and static portrait studios, is now mobile, global, and digital. And it's also viral, infecting our screens, littering our hard drives, and clogging up our collective mind's eye as never before. So photography, now no longer the preserve of the professional, but you know, anyone and everyone can do it. So artists are also doing it, picking up a camera just as they would any other tool, the brush or the chisel or the pencil. And perhaps this is what caused Paul Graham to stand up and say at MoMA's Photography Forum in 2010 that there remains a sizable part of the art world that simply does not get photography, implying that it doesn't take it seriously. But we're here to explore this dichotomy between the art world and the photography world. And we have a great panel of artists, authors, thinkers, and makers, international from New York and London. And we're going to begin with an artist. We're going to begin with Hannah Starkey, whose works have been described as emerging from the split second of the everyday and are resolved into what appears to be an extended moment in time. She's exhibited internationally with shows at the Mead Gallery, Warwick Art Centre, Coventry, Ormer Bard's Gallery in Belfast, Maureen Paley and Tanya Bonakdar in New York, and many others besides. So we'll have short discussions and from each of our panelists, and then a wider discussion and some questions later, so it's ready. For now, I'd like
Right. The photography and the art scene I refer to in this talk is related to the developments in this country. For photography is the key player in our visual culture, and the visual arts is just an aspect of that. It is a medium we are all invested in and are highly fluent in. I'm not going to stand up here and defend photography, and I'm not going to defend one camp against the other. To me, the argument is redundant. I understand where the debate is coming from and how difficult it was for the generation before me to find a context, an outlet for their work, and it is important to acknowledge and appreciate the contributions this generation made towards photography's passage into the contemporary art scene. But just to give you an idea of how I got to this point, I'd like to tell you about the journey that I have taken in photography. I grew up in Belfast, and I'm sure most people have heard of Belfast, and it was a political hotspot and in conflict for 30 years. And I was born into the beginning of that conflict. And as a child, I remember my dad, who was an architect, he was very keen on photography, and he, because Belfast was in the media spotlight, images from photojournalists were always on the front pages of the national and regional papers. So my dad had a particular respect for Don McCullen, and he would cut out Don McCullen's pictures and put them up. So they were very much around in my childhood, sort of in the newspapers and on the walls in my home. In retrospect, looking back at Don McCullen's pictures, what I love about them is the humanity and the grace in which he managed to reflect a very complex situation and the reality of the situation that resulted into 30 years of conflict. I then went on, and as a teenager, I am very dyslexic, and school was quite tricky. And when I was coming to do my O levels, the government changed the national curriculum and introduced GCSEs. And with that came photography. And I was given, a camera was put in my hand, and I was told to go and articulate myself in pictures. This was such an inspiration to me to be able to be released from the tyranny of words, which was my perspective. And the first pictures that I took, I then showed my mum, and her response was at seeing the pictures, "There you go, you have found your calling." And I, at the time, as a teenager, I didn't really think of that, think of what she meant by that, but the word stuck with me, and I now know exactly what she means by it. For me, photography is a way of being. It's not a career trajectory. It is a way of life. It's the way that I articulate myself in the world. I did my degree, did the A level, and then I went on to do a degree, or did my GCSE A level, and then I went on to do a degree in Edinburgh, which was a 4-year vocational photography degree, which meant that I was exposed and taught to practice the different territories within photography. So we did fashion, we did still life, we did reportage, street photography, advertising, and I learnt the vocabulary of how photography operates in our visual culture. It was also a course where the history of photography was very important, and I had a wonderful tutor who was passionate about photography, and in some ways infected me with that passion. I've always had a leaning towards the documentary tradition, and I see myself as working out of that tradition. So the history and the way of working has always been very important to me, irrespective of which genre I world I operate out of. My influences were British photographers like Chris Killip, and then the Walker Evans, W. Eugene Smith, Helen Levitt. They were all so inspiring to me when I was first showing them as a student. And not only with documentary, but also within the different aspects of photography, I learned how photographs were constructed, the codes and signifiers of each that made up photography in our visual culture. For me, why I love documentary photography and why I love photography is it is the medium that most succinctly expresses the human condition, and that is what I'm interested in. I left college and did a degree at the Royal College, and halfway through the Royal College at Easter when I went home, my dad died very suddenly. So I left the Royal College for a year. This was 95. I left for a year to be with my mum. And when I came back a year later, my original year that I started with had were getting ready for the degree show and leaving. And the year that I went into, I was very much aware that photography had changed. And it was beginning on all levels to be appreciated and valued by the contemporary art scene. So by the time I came to do my degree show, I was in a different world almost than the one that I'd left from my perspective. And it was at that point where Maureen Paley, who is the gallery that represents me and absolutely fantastic, that she saw the degree show and asked to represent me. And the one thing that I really valued about being able to work as a photographer in the art arena was the freedom and the autonomy it gave me to explore my medium. At the time, graduated with work that has the same concerns that it has today. If I could put it into one sentence, what it is that I'm interested in, I could say that the model of how I work, my constant is the subject is women, as a subject is women, and around that revolves my interest, learning and understanding of the language of photography. I initially started to photograph women because I wanted to engage with street and documentary photography, and I enjoyed the company of women and engaging with women and bringing this picture into being. Working out of a documentary tradition, you have a particular moral compass, and for me it's a hybrid of what I do, but for me personally it was very important never to just take a photograph of someone. At the very least I had to ask, and at the very least engage with the person that I was photographing. So that eventually led on to working in a collaborative sense between the subject and myself, and working in towards a picture that we were both happy with and expressed something quite sort of fundamental to us that had resonance, but particular to us. I mean, my work is in no way saying that this is how women are or how women should be. This is about my experience and the collaboration with someone else's experience. And also, I was very interested in finding the epic and the everyday, epic and the sublime in the everyday. Now it's become somewhat of a cliche, possibly, but that is what's wonderful about documentary and press and street photography to me. It is that kind of the process of observation and consideration, and finding something that resonates. And seems quite small, but actually resonates with everyone. And an example of that I would give is Don McCullough, one of Don McCullough's portraits, which is of an old Irish homeless man. And what's great about this portrait is, yes, it is a man that's had a difficult life, but it's also it sort of transcends that and becomes a portrait of almost a Neptune in a way. It's kind of, its power is extraordinary. So it works on the small level and the almighty level. I have continued working in this way and continued working with women. I have now two daughters, which I've spent the last 12 years bringing up. And I'm in the company of women very often, mothers, which I really enjoy and I value. And that also feeds into my work and in many ways has sensitized me to how women are portrayed in our popular visual culture. It's re-sensitized me, actually, because that's always been one of my issues. Coming from Belfast, I was politicized at a very early age, and I consider myself a feminist. And I would say the backbone of my work is still the feminist slogan. It's quite an old feminist slogan now. I think it's from the 70s, but the personal is political, and that's where I'm coming from. My process is a hybrid of... I've talked a long time. My process is a hybrid of whatever aspect of photography I want to engage with. And it's sort of part autobiographical, because I also feel in making a picture with somebody else in it that I have a responsibility also to give something of myself. That's something that grows with experience of motherhood and age, and it's something that I, as photography, I can always investigate and carry with me. What I love about it is the magic that the medium can bring to whatever. Aspect of it that or whatever discipline you're working in, and the thing about the art world is there are, working in as a photographer, there are no restrictions in how you use either from analog to digital, which was another thing that I traversed in terms of time, and that's been a great experience moving from analog to digital because I know each one intrinsically well. It's lovely to have the freedom to be able to work in whatever way you want. And the thing that's more important to me than anything else is actually not what I have to say about the picture or who I am, but what the picture does out in the world. And the art world, it brings it out into the world in some of the most unexpected ways. And a very quick story, because I know that I've coming up to my 8 minutes. A picture, going back to Belfast, a picture that I did recently, it's my most recent picture, and it was for an exhibition I had there. And I went back to make two new pictures, because I'd already photographed in Belfast in 1999. So I went back to revisit the areas of my childhood, if you like. And while I was there, I worked as a street photographer, and the interesting thing about Belfast is it's still quite segregated and there are barriers up between both communities, but almost as an outsider, I just walked for 4 days through all these barriers, and it was the most wonderful feeling. And I have my camera, and I was looking for something, a picture with meaning that would articulate something very special about Belfast. And one thing that I noticed was when I was walking, that the children would they would get involved in whatever area, they would kind of come up and they would ask me what I was doing, and they were very intelligent, very engaging. And so I eventually ended up making the two pictures about the children, which were turned out to be about 10 years old, which, you know, is almost the millennium baby, and also the child from that has that generation that had only seen the peace process. It gives you an idea of how I work. But actually, there is no one formula, and there is no one I can work in very different ways depending on what the picture needs. But to give you an example, I came across a scene that with children playing in a kind of, it was sort of beside the piece wall, but the photograph wasn't part of the piece wall. And I talked to the children, and they were lovely. And one of the comments that they made was there was nowhere to play, there was nowhere to climb, there were no trees, there were no playgrounds. And that was the thing that had struck me, that Belfast was doing fantastically well in terms of the city, the tourist aspect of the city, and I know it trickles down. But the communities that had suffered the most through the 30 years of conflict were still isolated through the political and the economic problems there. And I was just so shocked to see how I would have thought that these communities would have been funded the most. They would have been the first in line for the funding from the EUC or the Peace Process, whatever it was. And they weren't. So I made a picture about that. I made a picture about the children and how they, one girl in particular in the picture, and how this was her environment. But the interesting thing about the picture and what the scene, the location that I came across presented was it was an allegorical picture, as most of mine are. And with each layer, because it, also as a how I work, I weave layers in within the pictures. So you'll see that it's layers of meaning and also depth. But this picture, it just told you everything about the political situation, the then and the now. And it had a wonderful mural that had a kind of a scene. And look on the internet, you'll maybe then see what I'm trying to make you visualize. But it had a wonderful scene of, it was an old mural, possibly from the mid-80s, and it had sort of been worn down by time, but it was still visible, just. And on one side, there was a scene of this rural ideological scene, landscape. And on the other side, it was a political mural of political activists during the 70s. And it, for me, very succinctly, just talked about the ideologies behind such conflict. It had bollards in it, which the children played on, but they used to be used by the army as roadblocks, but they were now sort of the makeshift climbing frames, and my girl was on one of the bollards. And what is interesting about that picture, and what I was talking about in that, it's great to work out of the freedom of being in a gallery and being commissioned. But the picture was actually talking about the political and the economic situation today. And like I said before, the journey that a picture takes without me never fails to amaze me. And this one was then collected by the museum, but it was also put on the cover of a journal, a Northern Irish journal, a Northern and Southern Irish journal, that and with a little bit of text from me as to what it was about, that was then distributed to 5,000 politicians and senior civil servants and to the tea shop himself, who was also giving an interview in the magazine. And I had the freedom to make that picture, and the picture had the power to travel to the people it had to. And that's what astounds me about photography, and in some ways, its marriage with art. So that's all I've got to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Hannah. So more than art or photography, it's a way of articulating the world and getting away from the tyranny of words. And you might like to know, Hannah, I found a camera today that actually prints out a description rather than a photograph, rather than an image. So that might be quite useful. I'm now going to hand over, talking of words, to writer and curator Susan Bright, whose most recent books include Art Photography Now, for Thames and Hudson, and Autofocus, a self-portrait in contemporary photography. And curated exhibitions include How We Are Photographing Britain at Tate and Face of Fashion at the National Portrait Gallery, London. So which side of the art photography world divide do you land, Susan?
Okay. Well, there's a question, isn't there, which I hope I'll address. And photography is dogged with questions. The biggest one, which has plagued its very existence right from the beginning, was, is it art? Is it art? And we all know the answer to that. Yes, yes, it can be, but it can also be other things. And the question has shifted slightly now, and it's, what's its place in art? And the answer to that is a confused one. And I experienced that confusion on the coalface when in 2007 I co-curated How We Are with Val Williams, who has, as you probably know, a very diverse and eclectic way of thinking about photography. So going into an art gallery was both amusing because we were coming across questions about photography that we didn't ask, but also enormously frustrating. But that confusion about photography isn't just in galleries. It runs right across lots of different spaces. Auction houses are a great example of that confusion. What's sold under photography and what's sold under art, and that division seems very, very arbitrary to me. And I'm always asking people who work in auction houses, you know, where's it go, where's it go? And a great example is the Thomas Strutt. His black and white pictures used to be sold as photography and the colour sold as art. It's all sold as art now. In libraries, photography collections are in the archive collections, not the print collections, but you know, great shifts again are happening now. Commercial agencies are often very confused as well. If you look at an artist, they'll have art, editorial, advertising, and yet it's the same work that operates in all three circles. And then now it's getting interesting as well, again, with archive intervention, with appropriation coming back into fashion within art photography. When does an archive become art? Once an artist has got hold of it. You know, great examples here and next door as well. And Thomas Ruff being a great example, obviously, there. So that's a really interesting kind of boiling pot at the moment. And to be honest, I get this confusion. I have an art history background. I did 4 years of art history and I never ever looked at photography. I looked at one photographer. Can anyone stab a guess who that photographer might be? I'm quite old, so remember. It was Cindy Sherman. And it was in my feminism lecture in my third year of my BA. It wasn't in the fabric of learning about art. And people who work in museums come from an art history background. That's changing now as well, obviously. So my photographic epiphany didn't come till much later on, and it came with an Ansel Adams, and I've kind of grown out of now. But you know, this was a beautiful print. This was something that kind of got me in the belly. It was a three-dimensional print. I'd never seen layers of photographic complexity like that, and it blew me away. And that was it. That was my deal done with the medium. And it still confuses me, and that's why I like it. No, actually, I chose it because I thought it would be easy. I thought, it's a really short history, and get my head around it. And actually, it's a very complex history, and that's what really attracts me. Because it's like words. There's journalism, there's poems, there's novels, and photography is all that stuff. It's commercial images, it's art, it's fashion, it's snapshots. We're dealing with things like value and taste and trend and intention, which are tricky stuff, which critical theory debates endlessly, and photography is like a spanner in the works for that. And then, of course, you know, it's discursive. What was once art doesn't become art. What was once document becomes art, Ajay being perhaps the best example of that. And also, there's so many photographers. So many photographers and people who take photographs, who want to make a living out of being and making art photography. I don't buy into the cliche that everyone's a photographer now. I think you have to learn, like Hannah said, you have to learn the language of photography. We're very fluent, we're all very curious, but to be a connoisseur of photography, you have to learn it. And there's a language that needs to be learned. All this we know, okay? We're all coming from the same background here. So I'm going to kind of finish with a rallying call. And I'm going to say, I love the confusion. I love that the art world doesn't really get photography. And I think we should celebrate that confusion. And I think we should make the most of it, because we're living in a very wonderful period of photographic history where, as photography people, we can get away with stuff that we might not be able to in 10 years' time. As curators, we can put stuff into exhibitions that people don't understand. The art world hasn't hoovered it all up. As editors, we can put stuff into magazines that can displace or cause an interruption to the way of looking. And as photographers, you can do what the hell you like, because photography is going through yet another identity crisis, as it always seems to, endlessly, as technology progresses. Let's grab this moment and enjoy it and stop worrying. Stop being grumpy about the art world. Get out there, take pictures, curate shows, get onto self-publishing and enjoy the confusion and stop the hand-wringing. I'm fed up with photography being the underdog and people being defensive about it. We're lucky. We're lucky to be living at this time. We're lucky to have so many photographs. And we're still into something that everyone isn't into. So that's kind of cool too. And ways of looking have changed. I say to my students, how many photographs do you look at a day? And they go, between 500 and 1,000. That's an amazing thing to be looking at those kind of images. And they can digest them. They might not do anything with them. They don't look like I look because they haven't been taught to look like I look, but they do stuff with them, and they rip them and edit them and put them in places and they tumble them, and that's really, really exciting. So photography has always confused people. I think it will continue to confuse people. We get it, and we're the lucky ones, so that's my call to arms.
Thanks, Susan. I never heard of anyone who had a crush on Ansel Adams before, but and I love the idea that black and white equals photography and colour equals art. If only it were that simple. So on to another practitioner. We have Mitch Epstein up next, who's exhibited his work in numerous museums and galleries, not least here in the back room, two splendid works. His 8 books include American Power, the series on show, and Family Business from 2003, which won a book award. I can't pronounce that either. He won the 2011 Pictet Prize for his series American Power, and his works are in many major museum collections. So I'd like you to welcome Mitch.
Thank you. I'm not here to defend photography. It's not in a corner and needs no protection. I'd like to simply address tonight's topic from the perspective of someone who has worked as a photographer for the last 40 years. The primary reason photography, especially representational photography, gets short shrift in the art world is that it is not fully understood. This is partly because the medium is younger than others. There are centuries worth of written reflection on painting and sculpture, and a century's worth of rich and renowned reflection on film. About 40 years ago, John Sarkowski's pioneering ideas helped me, and others from my generation, understand the radical and unique nature of photography. But since then, there hasn't been a continual critical discourse, which is why it's so important that Jeff and Susan have taken up the challenge, amongst others, to further elucidate the meaning of photography. Some art world tastemakers denigrate representational photography because they believe it isn't inventive and imaginative enough. They dismiss it for showing the real world that we allegedly already know. But a great photograph makes us see the familiar anew. It gets us to discover something where we thought no discovery was possible. The surrealists love photographers such as Saatchi precisely because he made them see the extraordinary in the ordinary. Photography as art accomplishes a convergence of myth-making and mimesis that is impossible in any other medium. Writing might come closest. The fact that we see our actual world in a photograph tricks us into a particular state of mind that makes the recasting of that world all the more meaningful and shocking. The effect is subtle and deep. In an internet and media-driven era that values the obvious and quick, it's easy to overlook the masters of straight photography. It is a lot easier to see the art in a constructed work, painting, sculpture, or so-called conceptual photography, because you are seeing the artist's imagination front and center. This imagination has invented something that didn't exist. And this invention is the clear signal of an artistic realm. It is hard to see the art in a representational photograph because the artist has chosen to embed his imagination inside his uninvented subject matter. The photograph itself is the invention. What the art world forgets is that an imaginative concept does not have to be overt in order to be an animating force in a work of art. If the test of an artistic imagination were that it show itself fully and shout loudly, we'd have to say that Chekhov and Flaubert and Joan Didion are not great artists. Satyajit Ray and John Cassavetes and the Maisel brothers are not great artists. Montaigne and Vermeer are not great artists, for none of them flaunted their imagination, but seamlessly embedded it within the world they faithfully described. Which brings me to the silly definitions people make in order to divide and conquer. Somebody at some point came up with the term straight photography for representational photography. The opposite of straight photography is often referred to as conceptual photography. This is an artificial and mistaken divide. All photography is, in some sense, straight, because the artist has used a camera to replicate a reality, even if that reality is constructed. And all photography is conceptual, even if the artist has decided to keep his concept hidden behind his real-world content. No serious photographer, however reliant on the real world, just snaps his surroundings, as one misinformed critic put it. When I photograph a tree or a power plant, I do research, make sketches, try many times before I find the right vantage, light, and frame. I consider my equipment as a painter his brush and paint, or a sculptor her stone or steel. When every mechanical and compositional element is set, and to my mind ideal, the picture is still not made. It isn't made until something I bring to it from years of living, reading, looking, and thinking enters in. And then finally, if something unexplainable enters in, the picture is made. Art is the convergence of the right mechanical tools and formal choices within an artist's practiced intuition, athleticism, resourcefulness, and psychological resilience. That extra element that we cannot control is what Walker Evans called an unapproachable thing. It can't be named, but an artist needs to know about it and train himself to be ready to receive it. It is particularly fleeting in the practice of representational photography. In other words, it takes an awful lot of effort to make a fine, so-called straight photograph. People who love art will tire of the narrow-mindedness that excludes one kind of great art from another. Recently, I saw a show of Louis Baltz and Donald Judd. That's an illuminating juxtaposition. Would anyone here say that Baltz just snapped his surroundings? Another example of curatorial pluralism is the Columba Museum in Cologne. At the Columba, I found a Paul Tech installation piece made in 1969 next to Romanesque artifacts, across from a Lucas Rohrbach photograph near a medieval painting, alongside an Andy Warhol print, not far from a Richard Serra sculpture. The only thing these works overtly share is their quality. The museum's architect, Peter Zumthor, said working on the Columba collection taught him that, quote, "There is no difference between old art and new art, only between good art and bad art." Thank you.
Yeah, I'll just introduce you. Thank you, Mitch. And as you pointed out, maybe representation is the problem that the art world has. As someone like Eliot once said, we humans can't handle so much reality. So without further ado, I'm going to pass on to our last speaker. Jeff Dyer is the author of four novels and six genre-defying titles, including The Ongoing Moment. He's winner of the ICP Infinity Award for writing on photography. His selection of essays, otherwise known as The Human Condition, won the 2011 National Book Critics Circle Award for Criticism, and his most recent book, Zona, delves into the mysteries of Andrei Tarkovsky's film Stalker. So, thanks, Jeff.
Shit, that's slightly alarming. That's thrown me. 1458. Oh, yeah, that's some breaking news that I've just been handed. It's from somebody called Joseph Keeley, who says that there's the real battle for the recognition of pictorial photography is over. Oh, no, it's okay. Don't worry. That's it turns out that was from a 1906 issue of Camera Work, so it's not... It hasn't thrown me quite so badly. So I'll bring something up to date with another quote from somebody. This is in a book that was published just last month. Somebody asked, is photography an art? I really should have prepared better. That, it turns out, it was published last month, but looking at it now, I realize it was Susan Sontag, who's dead. And that was from her diaries, and that was an entry from 1965. There's another interesting entry from about the same time. All of this, of course, years before the essays that became on photography. She made the claim, art is never a photograph. It's a rather gnomic claim, that, suggesting that the terms in the question we're addressing tonight could actually be quite fruitfully reversed. Once we're alerted to that, we also become aware of a concealed assumption in the question we're addressing. This question of the status of photography is a subset of that hotly debated question. In fact, they were debating it on Newsnight only the other week when the Damien Hirst show opened. Is art even art? The fact that photography is an art maybe just kicks the can down the road, to use a metaphor which has been much in the news also recently with the euro crisis. It seems to me we could have chosen another title for tonight, a title such as Pushing an Open Door. If this had been a sort of one of those adversarial debates that Intelligence Square enjoyed, I rather fear we'd have had difficulty finding anyone who believed that photography wasn't an art. unless perhaps we got in touch with some weird bunch of renegades who are so completely out of touch with what's going on. I mean, who might they be? Oh, yeah, you're right, maybe some photographers, for whom it might actually be a badge of honor to call themselves photographers, not artists. I think it's always useful to consider a kind of adjacent world to the area that's being discussed. It's extremely unlikely that in another of the world's capitals, an almost identical discussion is going on about why jazz is not taken more seriously. And again, as with photography, you would find that this has been a much debated issue for a long time, even though the battle was effectively won ages ago. It turns out that why are we excluded claim, that sort of why are we so hard done by, it's one of the classic ways, if you'll excuse the pun, of trumpeting your achieved status. Or to put it in terms from another realm of activity, if you're a football manager, one of the best ways of ensuring that your team stays up is to persuade them that they're under constant threat of relegation. That, if you like, is a secondary stage or symptom. The tertiary stage, it seems to me, is to realize that promotion itself might be a form of internal relegation. That it's actually maybe helpful to feel excluded, to feel like the bad boy, rebellious outsider, to feel like a second-class citizen, even when you've actually been swathed in honours and prestige, because actually something is conceivably lost by being admitted and honoured. You might be better off, in other words, not being that which you long to be. And this is a good point, good time, I think, to quote Stieglitz on Edward Weston. If he'd only forget trying to be an artist, maybe he'd come close to being one. There's a great irony there, of course, because for Walker Evans, Stieglitz was himself, and I quote, a screaming aesthete who forced art into quotation marks and into unwanted earnestness. The problem now, it seems to me, is that art can force photographers not into unwanted earnestness, but into a kind of knee-jerk irony with a light conceptual gaze, or if you prefer a kind of culinary metaphor, a light conceptual reduction. The problems of achieved respectability are very, very obvious in jazz. Yes, of course people can play now with a kind of technical dexterity that's unbelievable, but something has been lost, I think, from the days when it was just a sort of semi-outlaw thing, a band of brothers recently converted to the junky religion of bebop by Charlie Parker. I think it's not for nothing that Joel Sternfeld talks of the 1970s as, and I'm quoting, the early Christian era of color photography, when you could actually be fed to the lions for practicing this new and rather heretical faith. And when, I mean, how different it is today, when there was really no chance of getting an exhibition if you were working in color. Certainly there was no chance of institutional acceptance. The irony, I think, is that while there was this kind of BC and AD idea of color photography, there was none before Eggleston had his show at MoMA. Now what happens is we keep having to backdate the discovery of color photography to accommodate some sort of individuals who are rather perversely and in a lonely way doing it sort of privately in color. I guess Saul Leiter is the really glorious lyrical example that comes to mind. Let's not forget, it's always been the case that some of the best art has been produced in circumstances where it was widely believed to be anything but art. The other thing to bear in mind, I think, is that it's not just one-way traffic. Of course, it's great that photographers can be shown at Tate Modern, but, and this for me was the great lesson of that Street and Studio show a few years ago, you also end up getting a load of artists included in photography shows. Artists who, although of course they're huge stars in the art world, they're actually pretty much irrelevant in the larger history of photography. Now, why am I being mean-spirited in this way? You know, I love being in the presence of celebrities. It's incredibly validating and all this kind of stuff. But the problem is there's a huge opportunity cost paid for including these art stars, and the people who pay that price is, of course, the photographers. It's ridiculous. It's stupid to have a show of photographs with street in the title, and not to show Alex Webb, it seems to me. I mention him because his work is available in colour and it comes very, very big. You know, he does it large. This question of size is so important. There's a very, very simple question you have to ask. Do these big pictures earn their size? Gursky's do, obviously. Michael Subotsky does there. But what I'm going to do now, I'm going to do that really vulgar thing and quote a little bit to you from my novel Jeff in Venice, Death in Varanasi, where the protagonist sees a load of photographs at the Venice Biennale. This is what he says. Needless to say, these pictures, like all the other photographs on offer, were the size of the raft of the Medusa. So what if they were just snapshots of someone jerking off in a leather armchair in an apartment in Zurich? So what if it was just a half-eaten, pre-packaged egg and cress sandwich abandoned on the bus seat of a bus shelter in Stockholm? So what if it was just a portrait of the artist's sour-faced grandmum pushing her shopping trolley round a poorly stocked supermarket in Barnsley? Blow them up big enough and they looked, well, they looked like shit, frankly, but they looked like art too. Now, the other thing that I think it's worth doing is we have to try to appeal to the essence of the medium. And I'll just throw out a couple of quotations from people. I find it very difficult to improve on this observation of George Bernard Shaw's, which the great photographer Philip Jones Griffith was so keen on quoting. He said that he would willingly exchange every single painting of Christ on the cross for just one snapshot. That's what photography has going for it, said George Bernard Shaw. The other thing, this thing about trying to get to the essence of the medium, again, I mean, I've never come across anything which has improved on John Tchaikovsky's, God, I really don't know how to pronounce his name, of course, Mitch did. But this is what Tchaikovsky said about Walker Evans. Evans's work is rooted in the photography of the earlier past and constitutes a reaffirmation of what has been, of what has always been photography's central sense of purpose and aesthetic, the precise and lucid description of significant fact. Fantastic definition, I think. I think also it's a very, very good thing that this debate hasn't taken the form of that sort of adversarial debate where you have to sort of put all your eggs on one in one basket and sort of stand on one side of the other, because it's really important that we are pluralist and not Manichaean about this. Of course, lots of artists use photography. There's lots of great stuff in this show. And, you know, as Lee Friedlander insists, you know, photography, it's a generous medium. It's the broadest of churches. I think, though, it's nice. There's a really simple kind of gorilla, not in the mist, but urban gorilla spelt like that. There's a really simple gorilla test you can do. You can go up to any big sort of work of art photograph, and then you just have a look at it, and you just get some blue tack and put next to it a sort of 6x8 Winogrand. It doesn't even have to be well printed. And just leave it there and see which picture commands the most enduring attention from the people who are at the gallery. Don't tell people I said you should do that. Thanks very much.
Thanks, Jeff. I'm to photography history and how art could never be a photograph, but I'll ask Susan Sontag next time she's in town. So for next few minutes, we're just going to have a bit of informal discussion before we open it to the floor. And I thought, to stop it becoming too much of a love-in, I might try and find out whether I can poke and produce a bit of a reaction and ask you, Hannah, whether we take the British critic John Berger as a gospel, his scathing assessment of photography was that it's only able to quote from appearances rather than translate them. In other words, a painter translates some reality, but a photographer just takes what's there. How would you, I know we're not here to defend the medium, but why aren't you just quoting rather than translating?
Yeah, well, I suppose that's probably a good reason, another reason why I construct my pictures. It is to try and build a picture that has layers that have to be peeled back, that in itself it is an experience. It's not just an object on the wall, framed object. It can transcend the object to an experience. So my language, it sort of encourages the viewer to interact in that way and to experience the picture, not only as a sort of a passive observer, but also to relate to the picture and maybe empathize with some aspects of it that might relate to them. So that's why it's loaded with cultural signifiers, codes, personal signifiers, sort of the abstract, the visual pleasure. It is intended as a real experience, and I know that's quite difficult to do, but I think it also maybe answers the debate with scale on a personal level. Although my pictures look quite small now, since when I started printing them up in 97. But I wanted to celebrate photography first and foremost with scale. But I also wanted it to envelop you, and the way it was constructed, because of the amount of detail and information, I wanted the eye to travel over the picture. So I see my way of working in photography as trying to get closer to the experience rather than the passive observer.
Well, taking on board what we've said about scale, I then thought, Susan, is there also a way in which art photography versus photography, you mentioned a bit about the auctions, the different types of auctions, one's photography, one's art. Do they have different costs, different prices? Does art have a different cost to a photograph?
Yeah, the cliche being that if it's an art, you add a zero, and that's kind of true.
One zero.
But having talked to a lot of people in auction houses, they really just want to do the best for their collectors and the best for that photographer. Mm. So they will place that photograph where they think they'll get the most money. Mm. And there's nothing kind of secret or mysterious about that. That they're in the business of making money. And if it will sell us through the contemporary art department, then that's where they'll pass it to.
Yeah, of course.
The Paul Graham statement that he made at the MoMA Forum, it was that very zero that I think in part what was eating him in a way to address this kind of disparity between the way photography falls out in terms of value, between photography world and a kind of ghettoization and art world. And so from the perspective of a practitioner, who's seeing an artist come along and all of a sudden appropriating the use of the medium and, you know, charging many, many times for the work. I think that was part of what provoked him. So, yeah. Anyways, I didn't mean to jump in.
No, that's fine. And I was going to come to you as well because you mentioned Lewis Boltz, and I love his quote. He had a famous 1975 show about landscape photographers, and he said that the primary impetus for a photographer should be to take pictures that appeared to be without author or art. In other words, you know, this kind of window idea. And I wondered whether, you know, he wasn't defending the medium in a way. He was just saying that he was just merely this conduit for...
Well, it's interesting because why do most photographers not sign, you know, their mats in front of the picture? I mean, I think that also speaks to the way in which the authorship is very embedded, as I spoke about. But I don't think that in any way means that that Lewis is saying that the authorship is not absolutely present and invested in the work. And you can't fashion bodies of work. You can't have a sustained practice and build a life of making pictures unless you have, unless you're engaged with the authorship of the work. And so that's certainly evidenced as you walk around a show like this one, where you see the way certain ideas get explored through the course of a series.
And I wondered also whether, we talked about separate prices or separate costs, whether there's also this thing that they're almost like a, there's almost a separate world of critics, a separate world of writers for photography as opposed to art. And you've straddled both of those, but you're known as a critic and a writer on photography. Do you think there is still a kind of ghetto of appreciation that is specific to photography?
Yeah, I mean, I suppose this would come under the heading of what I was talking about. People love to think they're in a ghetto. And I think, but one ghetto that I really don't think it's a good idea to get into is the academic ghetto. And now, although I've been so rude about him in print, let's give him some in a live audience. I mean, you know that guy, Michael Fried, who wrote that unbelievable book, Why Photography as an Art Matters More, what a blah, blah, blah. You know, that was a book that enjoyed a certain kind of currency in academic circles. Every photographer I know, everybody who was even involved in photography, they were pissing their pants reading that book. The idea that this guy had just, after his years spent sort of doing all this 18th century, he just sort of decided, oh yeah, now I will hold forth on photography. He was just really so lagging so far behind. Just to sort of give some more sort of anecdotal versions of that, Todd Papageorge, who's somebody who's very, very up on, you know, keeps really up on writing about photography, you know, he said that, you know, Gary Winogrand, he wasn't reading Sontag and Janet Malcolm and John Berger or Roland Barthes. He'd have thought it was an absolute joke. Now, you know, I think those people are great writers on photography, but I'm also reminded that a symposium at SF MoMA, when a load of us, we were all blowing on about photography, and it was a 2-day symposium. Lee Friedlander didn't bother coming back for the second day because, quite right, I mean, what can I tell? I mean, I was one of the least theoretical ones. Some of them were real sort of discourse merchants. What did he have to learn about photography from us? You know, and I think really, I don't know, I mean, you know, Hannah and Mitch would know more about this, but I think the sort of most valuable discussion that takes place within photographers is going to, I think a lot of it would be sort of technical, really. I suspect photographers are quite geeky at some. Are you pretty geeky, Mitch?
Not as geeky as Lee Friedlander.
Okay, well.
Well, it's funny you mention that, that SF MoMA symposium, because I read the transcripts. Interesting that I picked out something that Philip Lorca de Corchia said about, where, you know, the symposium was about whether photography was dead, which seemed to me to be...
No, was it over?
Was it over? Mm. I don't... Yeah, okay. But it seemed to me to be a silly question.
Overblown.
We haven't figured out whether it's art and it's already over.
But he said something interesting. He said that the trick of photography, you can call it a chemical trick or a digital trick or whatever, has ceased to fascinate. So whether the idea that this kind of magical light writing, that, you know, the photography has sort of, we're over that, we're over the magic of photography.
I think that's rubbish.
Yeah.
I think it's a rather cynical position.
It continues to dazzle, absolutely.
Yeah. The right ones, the best ones, and they're very hard to find. Okay, right. And that's what makes it so special.
But, you know, as Susan mentioned, you know, she has students that are consuming 500 or 1,000 pictures in a sitting. Mm. And, you know, while there is a certain usefulness to just that kind of, you know, I guess that's like replacement for the sort of TV channel surfing that I did, you know, when I was a kid, I think it, you know, it inhibits the kind of reading and contemplation, the kind of quiet, introspective engagement that photography calls out for. And, you know, I go back again to Sarkowski because I think, you know, I know Gary Winogran read Sarkowski and certainly revered him deeply. And Sarkowski was very helpful to Winogran because he helped him to define his own position and support it. But Sarkowski wrote from a cultural perspective. He wrote about the very mechanics, the very nature of the medium, but he did it in a way that illuminated it, that brought mystery to it, and that, you know, and that pointed to the overwhelming complexity of it, because there is so much to look at in pictures to kind of bring understanding to.
If anyone doesn't know who Sarkowski is, if I pronounce that right, he's New York sort of uber curator, the sort of czar of photography.
Well, he's dead
at the moment.
Now,
he was.
Passed,
he was, yeah, in the 70s.
But he was the formative curator post Edward Steichen at the Museum of Modern Art. Came there, kind of plucked, not trained to be a curator. He was a photographer, so he already had the history of being a practitioner. But he was somebody who was ready to receive that position and to rise to the challenge of it at a time where photography was not about marketplace. There was no gallery system. And so photographers were not making pictures in the 60s going into the 70s art remuneration. Very few, if any, you know. So it was useful criticism, unlike some of the very, not useless, but very philosophical criticism, like Sontag in some ways and Barthes. I mean, Sontag but went on to revise her position, certainly times. From what was quoted to have said in 1965 from her diary.
I said, with it being an exciting time for photography, I also think it's a very exciting time for photography writing, because Barthes and Sontag can only go so far. They could never have predicted the web. They could never have predicted the maelstrom of images. So now's a really exciting time for people who are interested in writing to take that challenge as well and start a new discourse, start a new way of thinking about how we receive images and how they're out there in the world.
A new discourse that doesn't involve use of the word
discourse.
Discourse.
Or paradigm.
Yeah. Can we just go back to Philip Lorca de Corsia, who was at this thing? I mean, he's a great photographer. He's just genius, the stuff he says, and I've forgotten most of it, but this famous line of his, which seems to me we could have used as an epigraph for tonight, he said, "Photography is a foreign language that everyone believes they're fluent in." And then just to add something to Ossian's question, when he was saying, has some of the magic gone out of that photography thing? I always think of that thing that Chuck Close said when he said, photography never got any better than it was in 1840. And on the one hand, you could think this is a sort of a deeply tired remark, a kind of resignation. I see it slightly differently. I see it as somebody who's saying that, my God, the power of that discovery then is so great that actually we're still just getting used to it.
Yeah. I'm going to open it up to questions in a minute, so if you all prepare to thrust your hands up, I'm going to sort of end with one more to try and clear up this idea about Mitch said that all photography is conceptual and all art is also, has a photography. But is there a difference between a photograph that you sort of need to know the backstory behind, rather than a photograph that you can just see within the frame everything that you need to know? Whether there's a kind of conceptual photography, whether that is art photography, or whether that also enters into the mind of a straight photographer?
I'm not quite.
Well, let's say, do you get the whole? All you need to see is in the frame, or do you have to read a label that tells you this was appropriated?
I think it depends on the work. Some work and some artists will make text and text on the wall as part of the experience of viewing the work. I personally do not feel that way. I feel that what I want to do with my pictures needs to be embedded in those pictures, which isn't to say that I may not write text as a complement to them, as an afterword in a book, or as notes that could then be published, but I want the experience of the work to be a visual one, and one that isn't scripted or captioned. But that's because I believe that that in some way, when it's scripted, that I'm directing a kind of reading of the work. And so it's those qualities that, you know, that harken back to what Walker Evans said, or, you know, since Winogrand seems to be, the picture that we have to kind of, in a way, hold the wall next to. His quote goes, "There's nothing as mysterious as a fact clearly described." And there's something about that mystery that, you know, yet again, it's not explainable. And so by putting text, sometimes it can be useful, but it also can be reductive. And I think that that's, you know, we're making pictures, we're putting them on the wall. They need to hold the wall in the same way that a painting holds the wall or a sculpture holds the floor.
I agree. Yeah. I mean, that is the challenge as a photographer, that the single image, still mute single image encompasses everything within it. And I love that about photography.
Just lastly, because I think, you know, scale came up as an important phenomenon, and I think it is, you know, one that does need to be addressed more critically, because it often, and myself too, not, I don't believe with these pictures, but there are times where the scale is undeniably gratuitous and market-driven, and I think the consequence of the art school industrial complex, which we do have to call into question.
Yeah, I think that, just to expand on that a bit, it's always important to be materialist about things. And I sort of remember when, Robert Capa said to Cartier-Bresson, you know, call yourself a photojournalist when he was going to do whatever it was. You know, you won't get anywhere if you just say you're a photographer. And so the great heyday of the great sort of forums for photographers on assignment, Life, Time, the Sunday Times magazine here, you know, that great, you know, back in the days when Berger was writing about photography in the 70s, you would open the Sunday Times, and as Hannah would say, that'd be these Don McCullough and all this kind of stuff. Now gradually those options diminished. And that coincided with an increase in possibilities of people earning money by selling stuff to galleries. So there is always, I think, an economic thing that's powering any kind of conceptual shift in the... God, I've backed myself into a corner where I'm going to use the word paradigm there.
Okay. Well, let's open it up to the floor. If anyone's got any questions, put your hand up and I will whisk a microphone over to you, to that lady over on the far side in the white top. Can you see her? She's over there. Yeah, thanks. We'll try and get half a dozen in before we wrap up. And you can address it to whoever you like or to anyone.
Okay. Well, it's to everyone, really. No one's mentioned Photoshop. You've talked about photographing the real world, but I was just wondering, what's the place of Photoshop and digital manipulation in art photography?
Photoshop.
I think they're two separate things. Photography doesn't need Photoshop. But depending on how you're working, you can run parallels with intervention and molding the image to maybe almost sort of to speak of a different language that can run alongside the language of photography. It's not an extension. I think I see it as quite separate. And I actually see digital as almost a medium in itself, in a way. It has its own language. And I mean, you know, in photography, there have always been darkroom tricks, and you could, depending on how you use digital, you could say that there hasn't really been much of a shift,
But when I talk about digital, I almost feel like I have to learn a completely new language to engage with it and to use it. That's what I think.
I think it's a funny question. Any debate that I go to about photography, there's always two questions. One is, what about Photoshop? And what about the dark rooms? Regardless of what the subject of the panel is.
No, it's about the intention.
Yeah, and
it's about the effectiveness of the picture as opposed to how it was, how it's come about, possibly.
Yeah, I don't understand the anxiety.
No.
For me.
No, I mean, I don't think it's an anxiety, but I think, I really do feel that photography in itself does not need it. It's not an extension of photography, but in itself it is almost a new medium, which we're only at the beginning of.
Photoshop needs photography, though.
Yeah.
I hate Photoshop because I always have to put a capital P whenever I write it, and it annoys me. Another question, please, to anyone? Oh, yes, here in the front. Thank you.
Hi, thanks. To any of the panellists, but maybe probably for Susan, no one had mentioned reproduction and the fact that photos can be reproduced, and I didn't know if that may be, maybe not just for the market, but even culturally demystified photography, and what you thought of that.
I just think art photography, you know, it comes in all shapes and sizes, and Cartier-Bresson didn't edition, and Hannah editions probably to five, yes?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And each has got to find their own comfortable place where they're comfortable, they're happy with that.
Do you think not having a unique object is one of the things that separates it from art, in quotes?
Well, some art photography is unique, photograms are unique. so no, I don't.
But it puts it more into the camp of the print medium. Like engraving and etchings and other multiples. And so that's just the fact of it. And photography wouldn't ever, I don't think, have been additioned had it not been a market-motivated, play. So, you know, it's... and there are many photographers who don't edit. Lee Friedlander, he wouldn't ever addition his work because he's philosophically opposed to the idea. You know, because the very beauty of photography is it's something that can be generated in multiples. And if you look at collections of photography going back through history, also, one of the fascinating things is the way in which photographers have printed their work differently, the same negative, for instance, over periods of time, as new materials have developed, and as their relationship to the negative, to the print itself, has changed. And I have made prints now, say, from a negative in the 70s, using Photoshop, which is a tool, a useful tool, that have enabled me to, to make color corrections and to make the facsimile of something that was more like how I maybe ideally could have printed in the 70s, but I couldn't as a straight, print in an enlarger. Now, so these are complex things.
Sorry, I suffer from brain lag, so actually I realised I wanted to reply to the earlier question about Photoshop. I think there's some really interesting work being done now by people who are taking some of the kind of canonical photographs of the past and adjusting them. So the guy, I bet you know his name, Mitch, he's taken those August Sander portraits and he's removed the people from them so that all you get is the background. And I think this is a really, it actually makes you look at the August Sander photographs again, anew. Or there's that guy called Pavel Maria Schmeichel who's taken those sort of famous war photographs and has removed the defining events. So I think this is a nice form of kind of commentary on creative commentary, I guess you would call it.
To look again, really, doesn't it?
Oh, absolutely, yes, yeah.
Another question from this gentleman here. Wait for the microphone, then they can hear you in the worldwide.
Sorry to carry on about the Photoshop debate, but I think it's just a tool as well. I don't think it's separate. I mean, photographers struggled in the darkroom for years trying to get the perfect print, and Adams devised the zone system to try and do that pre-visualization. And Photoshop now enables the practitioner to actually, if I can imagine it, I can realize it. There's a lot more control than the analog process. And I think there's a lot of romanticism about analog, which is holding the debate back on the digital world of photography. But there's a lot more control over the image now, I think.
That's a nice point about the romanticism of analog. Is there too much of that in the photography world rather than the art world?
But my students romanticize it.
Yeah.
Very much so. And they'll print with all the dust on it to show that it's analog.
Right.
You know, there's very much, you know, like filmmakers, young student filmmakers will use film, you know, so there is a romanticizing definitely.
And it still is different. It feels different. An 8x10 neg will have a quality of light that will be and colour which will be very different from a digitally reproduced file. That feeling is getting less and less perceptible, possibly, as 8x10 disappears and digital is more ubiquitous.
And arguably that physical nature brings it closer to an art object, because we talk about the uniqueness of an art object. Perhaps that sort of fetishization, I can't even say it, of the object, the very print, the quality of the print might take us closer to the art object.
Having just done myself an analog piece of work, I've shot film throughout, but my print post-production, my printmaking has been through scanning my negatives, and you know, so it's a kind of a hybrid. But I did an analog piece of work, and what's interesting for me is that it's sort of heightened the performative. Aspects of the practice. The pictures have to get made in camera. And you are like, you know, the quarterback, you know, in the play. And you have to get it all to happen in a way that is going to suit your intention and, you know, be the picture that you want, because there's no adulterating it afterwards. So I think it kind of heightens and deepens, you know, some of what we kind of as photographers took for granted pre-digital. I had one interesting thing to say, that just because it's so kind of timely, because I think the Berger quote, I mean, I think it's maybe it's fascinating, but maybe, you know, it has greater meaning in the larger context of Berger's thinking about photography. But I saw a show today at Simon Lee where there's a painter whose at least two of the paintings were from William Eggleston's Guide. One is the woman sitting on the couch. Not necessarily very. So, you know, here is an example of painting actually quoting photography, and that really is precisely quoting in a way that I don't believe, in fact, photography is simply quoting. And I think apt to that also is a wonderful book that you've written, The Ongoing Moment, which...
I like that book.
Yeah, well, I did too. but it's relevant in that it speaks to the conversation, the life of the conversation between pictures. And that it's not simply one picture that leads to another picture in a literal fashion, but it's this cumulative, mammoth now subset of pictures, but within, you know, the history of serious photography, it's more limited. And it's that knowledge of that that has, in a way, helped to kind of further it along. And I think that that's part of what the issue is with some of what goes on in the art world side, where artists do come to use photography, and they're coming close to things that have been done through the photographic history, but not necessarily with the depth of, you know, kind of engaged understanding of that historical practice.
Don't be too nice to Jeff, because you could always tell Michael Fried what he said about him when you see him tomorrow.
I'm not seeing him
one
tomorrow,
more question. We've got a question right at the back. There's a gentleman holding up his hand. Yeah, thanks.
Hello. It's been said in this talk that this is an exciting time for photography, And Hannah talked about the time that she discovered photography in GCSE. As you know, in this country, there have been deep and ideological cuts to arts funding in education. How do you think this is going to affect photography? Is it going to be? Are we going to be subjected to more portraits from a sort of elite gaze? And what is a photographer's responsibility to future generations of photographers?
Education. Does anyone want to deal with what will happen to photography if we don't have proper education, either in this country or in the States? I don't mind.
Well, I mean, it seems to me, in a way, there's this is a debate that we're having tonight of purely local interest, in a way. And just to sort of enlarge on that question a bit, I mean, I occasionally come across American photographers, very, very well established, who don't have a gallery in this country. And before they've even asked me if I could help them get a gallery, I say, God, don't worry, I'm a person of such enormous influence. I'll get you a gallery. Don't worry about it. They weren't worried. And I have to say, I've enjoyed 100% failure rate doing that. And this is not a cause of concern to them at all, because this is something that's really, really, I think it's true. We forget that in America, photography is so... It's so big and important and exciting, and so many people are in it. The truth is, they don't really give a toss what happens on this little island or this little rock in the middle of the Atlantic here. And we, you know, we've always been rather backward. I don't know when we first appointed the curator of photography at Tate. It was three years ago. You know, so it really is. We have to bear in mind that we are a bit of a backwater here. And I hand over to other people.
We don't have the institutions of, say, New York or Paris in terms of a dedicated large space. We're waiting for the Photographers' Gallery to reopen later in May, so that will be our sort of dedicated space. But
yeah,
we
but
are lacking.
We do have our fantastic universities all around the country producing great students. That's what Britain really does have. And it produces a lot, and that's something really that, if that is being cut, I don't know, I live in the States now, so if that is being, I don't know about the cuts, if that is being cut, that is a serious cause for concern. You know, when I lived here 5 years ago, people were saying, oh, there's producing so many photographers. But, you know, photographers don't actually have to be photographers. They can go into a whole host of other professions. And If there isn't an outlet there anymore, then that is a serious cause for concern. I think there's so much pressure put upon the Photographers' Gallery. It's only one gallery. Yeah, it's a small gallery. And not enough, really, the attention on the education.
I think one of the real challenges is visual literacy, period. And that's one of the things, at least as it's been told to me, that these galleries really advocate, you know, to bringing young people in and to exposing them, but also in a critical way, teaching them and broadening their way of thinking about visual languages. Mm, and so that's, you know, it's not just about, I think, the upper level, but really the lower level.
Mm, yeah, absolutely. Yes, they. If you think of it as in terms of the impact it has on our visual culture, it's imperative that we understand and forward the language. And galleries like the Photographers' Gallery play a very important role in that, in the same way that, you know, a belated exhibition like Cruel and Tender eventually does. But before that's picked up, there are institutions that are educating behind the scenes, which is very important because, you know, I think in terms of society, we're much more visually oriented than web-based. And that's just going to get more so. And we're very influenced by the 3,000 or 1,000 pictures we see every day, and subliminally influenced. So it's such a powerful language that it's not something that you can underestimate or cut.
Do we have time for one more question? One more question. The lady in the center row here, please, halfway up with the rainbow top. Thanks.
So we talk about photography and what is it now? And my question is, it seems to me a lot of photographers amuse themselves with making short films or long films. Do you see it as inevitable evolution of the media itself, photography? Is it unnecessary or is that passing fancy? Do you include it in your thoughts about photography now, that the fact is that there's so much more films also being made, not just photographs, as it were? Or is it dictated by the technology being so much more advanced that it's so much easier?
I think if photographers want to make films, great.
I mean, I think a funny thing is, actually, I remember when I think it was early 2000, and a fellow graduate of mine, we were both going through the gallery system, and his gallery suggested to him, after photography had somewhat, there was a lot of photography around, and some people may say that it peaked. In my view, the more photography, the better, even the not-so-good photography, because it still extends the language in some ways. It still makes us try to understand why it isn't good. But it was suggested to him that maybe he move on to video art, and I think that did actually happen to quite a few photographers or artists or photographers at that time. I mean, for me personally, I find, like I said earlier, the most challenging aspect of photography is to bring everything into the single frame. That I love the power of the single frame. So I wouldn't ever move into video art, but film, feature film, is a whole different beast. I don't think you can say, oh, because I'm a photographer, I'll then make film. It's not necessarily a natural progression. But I do remember a time within the certain galleries suggested that maybe move on to the next hot thing.
And also I think the way that we're thinking about art photography is quite monolithic, and it's not. It can be video, and it can be sculpture, and it can be installation. It's not necessarily big colour prints. That's just one type of art photography. And I think we've all kind of got that in our heads that we're talking about big colour photography, and that's not what art photography is. It's much more interesting than that.
Thankfully. Yeah.
Well, I'll just end by saying that we started off saying there were millions of images in the world and seemingly never ending, but that just means that we need more editors, sifters and magpies to find those jewels among the churn of the mundane of the imagery. So I'd like to end by saying today's artists and photographers aren't simply or strictly photographers any more than they're also curators or archivists or storytellers or framers of some notion of reality or of their own invented universes. So I'd like to thank the panel for coming today and thank our hosts. Thanks very much.